Hi, welcome to iEducator. This is Teacher Jeff. I'm an educator and an engineer by profession. And today we will discuss chapter one. And chapter one is all about methods, standards, and work design introduction. And in today's lesson, there are three key areas that I'm going to be highlighting today. First, we have productivity importance. Second, methods and standard scope. And finally, we have historical development. Now, in order for us to get started, let us discuss first the first key area, which is productivity importance. Now, take note that certain changes continually taking place in the industrial and business environment must be considered both economically and practically. Now, these include the globalization of both the market and the producer, and the growth of the service sector, the computerization of all facets of an enterprise, and the ever-expanding applications of the internet and the web. The only way a business or enterprise can grow and increase its profitability is by increasing its productivity. So what is meant by productivity improvement then? If we see productivity improvement, it refers to the increase in output per work hour or time expended. Now, the United States, if you may know, has long enjoyed the world's highest productivity because over the last 100 years, productivity in the United States has increased approximately 4% per year. However, in the last decade, the U.S. rate of productivity improvement has been exceeded by that of Japan, Korea, and Germany, and it may soon be challenged by China. Now, the fundamental tools that result in increased productivity include methods, time study standards, frequently referred to as work measurement, and second, we have work design. Now, of the total cost of the typical metal products manufacturing enterprise, 12% is direct labor, 45% is direct material, and 43% is overhead. Now, all aspects of a business or industry, such as sales, finance, production, engineering, cost, maintenance, and management provide fertile areas for the application of methods, standards, and work design. Too often, people actually consider only production when other aspects of the enterprise could also profit from the application of productivity. Today, most U.S. businesses and industries are by necessity restructuring themselves by downsizing to operate more effectively in an increasingly competitive world. Now, with greater intensity than ever before, we are actually addressing cost reduction and quality improvement through productivity improvement. We are also critically examining all non-value business components, those that do not contribute to their profitability. Now, since the production area within manufacturing industries utilizes the greatest number of engineers in methods, standards, and work design efforts, this text will treat that field in greater detail than any other. However, examples from other areas of the manufacturing industry, such as the maintenance, transportation, sales, and management, as well as the service industry, will be provided. Traditional areas of opportunity for students enrolled in engineering, industrial management, business administration, industrial psychology, and labor management relations are, first, we have work measurement. Another area of opportunities, we have work methods and design. We have production engineering. We have manufacturing analysis and control, facilities planning, wage administration, ergonomics and safety. So we have, in this case, we have ergonomics at home. One example would be home computing or games. We have handheld devices, and we also have gardening, and we also have workplace ergonomics. One example would be material handling. We have work height positioning, tools and materials as well. And aside from that, another area of opportunities for students, that would be production and inventory control, and we also have quality control. However, these areas of opportunity are not confined to manufacturing industries only. In fact, they exist and are equally important in such enterprises as department stores, hotels, educational institutions, hospitals, banks, airlines, insurance offices, military service centers, government agencies, and retirement complexes. Now, today, in the United States, only about 10% of the total labor force is employed in manufacturing industries, and the remaining 90% is engaged in service industries or staff-related positions. As the U.S. becomes ever more service industry-oriented, the philosophies and techniques of methods, standards, and work design must also be utilized in the service sector. Wherever people, materials, and facilities interact to obtain some objective, productivity can be improved through the intelligent applications of methods, standards, and work design. Now, in this case, the production area of an industry is key to success. And as they say, production area is the heart of the organization, because here, materials are requisitioned and controlled. The sequence of operations, inspections, and methods is determined. Tools are ordered. Time values are assigned. Work is scheduled, dispatched, and followed up, and customers are kept satisfied with quality products delivered on time. And similarly, the methods, standards, and work design activity is the key part of the production group, because here, more than in any other place, people determine whether a product is going to be produced in a competitive basis through efficient workstations, tooling, and worker and machine relationships. Here is where they are creative in improving existing methods and products and maintaining good labor relations through fair labor standards. So what is the objective of the manufacturing manager then? Well, the objective of the manufacturing manager is to produce a quality product on schedule at the lowest possible cost with a minimum of capital investment and a maximum of employee satisfaction. And the focus of the reliability and quality control manager is to maintain engineering specifications and satisfy customers with the product's quality level and reliability over its expected life. Now, the production control manager is actually and principally interested in establishing and maintaining production schedules with due regard for both customer needs and favorable economics obtainable with careful scheduling. The maintenance manager is primarily concerned with minimizing facility downtime due to unscheduled breakdowns and repairs, because in the production setting, we cannot deny the fact that there are really instances where the production can be brought into halt because of machine breakdown or bug down, especially if the production manager or the maintenance team are not able to conduct, let's say, preventive maintenance first. Okay, if that makes sense. And as you can see in figure 1.1, it actually illustrates the relationship of all these areas and influence of methods, standards, and work design on overall production. Okay, as you can notice, they are interrelated with each other and they are working hand in hand. They coordinate with each other to attain a common goal. And the next key area that we're going to be discussing today, that would be methods and standard scope. So what is the scope of methods and standard? How broad is the scope? Now, when we say methods engineering, it includes designing. So you design a workstation, maybe. You design a layout, maybe, and so on and so forth. And then you also create and select the best manufacturing methods, processes, tools, and equipment, and skills to manufacture a product based on these specifications that have been developed by the product engineering section. Again, it includes designing. So you design, may it be a workstation, a layout, or whatsoever. And you also create and select the best manufacturing method. Once you have selected the best manufacturing method, processes, tools, and equipment, you also need to select the best person or the best labor to be able to carry out the process, okay? And the best labor, that refers to the skills to manufacture a product based on the specification given by the product engineering section. Now, when the best method interfaces with the best skills available, or with the best method plus the best person or the most qualified person to manufacture a product, an efficient worker-machine relationship exists. Okay, so you cannot just select a best method but a poor skill, and you cannot select a poor method and a best skill. It should be the best method and the best skill in order for us to be able to achieve an efficient worker-machine relationship. And once the complete method has been established, a standard time for the product must be determined. And furthermore, there is the responsibility to see that predetermined standards are met, workers are adequately compensated for their output, skills, responsibilities, and experience, because this is also one to motivate our employees. And also, workers have a feeling of satisfaction from the work that they do, meaning to say they are feeling satisfied, feeling valued workers. So we should also look into them in a way that we are able to motivate them as our employees. And the overall procedure includes defining the problem, breaking the job down into operations, and then once we have broken down the job into operations, it is then time for us to analyze each operation to determine the most economical manufacturing procedure for the quantity involved, with due regard for operator safety and job interest. Again, in this case, in methods engineering, safety is given as the top priority, okay? The safety of our employees, applying proper time values, and then following through to ensure that the prescribed method is put into operation. Now, as you can see in figure 1.2, it illustrates the opportunities for reducing the standard manufacturing time through the application of methods engineering and time study. And on the other hand, the terms operation analysis, work design, work simplification, methods engineering, and corporate re-engineering are frequently used synonymous. And in most cases, The person is referring to a technique for increasing the production per unit of time or decreasing the cost per unit output. In other words, productivity improvement. However, methods engineering as defined in this text entails analysis at two different times during the history of a product. First, the methods engineer is responsible for designing and developing the various work centers where the product will be produced. Okay. And secondly, the engineer must continually restudy the work centers to find a better way to produce the product and or improve its quality. So the very first thing that a methods engineer should do is to design the workstation of the employees. And after designing the workstation, the best workstation as possible, the methods engineer should also make sure to restudy the workstation in order for, this is what we call continuous improvement. We need to find better ways on how the product should be manufactured at a lesser time, but without sacrificing quality, of course. Now, in recent years, this second analysis has been called corporate re-engineering. So in this regard, corporate re-engineering is we recognize that a business must introduce changes if it is to continue profitable operation. And having said that, it may be desirable to introduce changes outside the manufacturing area. So how are we supposed to do that? Well, often, profit margins may be enhanced through positive changes in such areas as accounting, inventory management. We also have materials planning or materials requirements planning or MRP. We also have logistics, the human resources management as well. But can information automation provide dramatic rewards in all these areas? Well, actually, yes. It actually can, because the more thorough the method study during the planning stages, the less the necessity for additional method studies during the life of the product. And methods engineering can also be defined as something that implies the utilization of technological capability. So what do we mean by this? If we say imply the utilization of technological capability, what we mean about that is that it implies the utilization of technological capability primarily because of methods engineering. Improvements in productivity are never ending, meaning to say it's incessant, it's never ending. That is why we have what we call continuous improvement or Kaizen. Now, what I mean about that is that the productivity differential resulting from technological innovation can be of such magnitude that developed countries will always be able to maintain competitiveness with low-wage developing countries. In fact, research and development, or R&D, leading to new technology is therefore essential to methods engineering. Now, the 10 countries with the highest R&D expenditures per worker, as reported by the United Nations Industrial Development Organization 1985, are the United States of America. We have Switzerland. We have Sweden. We have Netherlands, Germany, Norway. We have France, Israel, Belgium, and Japan. Now, these countries are among the leaders in productivity. So as long as they continue to emphasize research and development, methods engineering through technological innovation will be instrument in their ability to provide high-level goods and services. Now, methods engineers use a systematic procedure to develop a work center, produce a product, or provide a service, as you can see in figure 1.3. Now, as you can see in figure 1.3, this procedure is outlined and It summarizes the flow of the text. Now, as you can notice, each step is detailed in a later chapter. And take note that steps 6 and 7 are not strictly part of the method study, but are necessary in a fully functioning work center. Now, the principal steps in a methods engineering program or methods analysis, first, we have selecting the project. Next, we have getting and presenting data. Third, we have analyzing data. Fourth, we have developing the ideal method. Fifth, we have presenting and installing the method. Sixth, we have developing job analysis, followed by establishing time standards. And finally, we have following up. Now, in order for us to better understand each of these principal steps in a methods engineering program or method study, let us discuss them one by one. So what do we mean by selecting the project? Now, in step one, selecting the project, typically the projects are selected, or the project selected rather, represent either it's a new product or existing product that have high cost of manufacture and a low profit. Again, in selecting the project, we need to weigh in if that project is something that we can improve. Okay? If this is something that we can improve, meaning to say it's either that's a new product or existing product that have a high cost of manufacture and a low profit. Okay? Because if it has high cost of manufacturing and it doesn't produce much of the company's profit, then there's something that we need to improve for this particular product. And also, products that are currently experiencing difficulties in maintaining quality and are having problems meeting competition are logical projects for methods engineering. Again, in selecting the project, in step number one, selecting the project, the projects that we normally select, it's either new product or existing product, but these products should be having high cost of manufacture and low profit. And second, products that are currently experiencing difficulties in maintaining quality and having problems meeting competition. And once we have already selected our project, the next step that we need to do is to get and present the data. Now, what do we do here? If you are a methods engineer, well, if you are a methods engineer, in getting and presenting the data, what methods engineers usually do is that they usually assemble all the important facts relating to that chosen product or service. These include drawings and specifications, quantity requirements, delivery requirements, and projections of the anticipated life of the product or service. And once all important information has been acquired, we need to record it in an orderly form for study and analysis. Now, the development of process charts at this point is very helpful. And again, this will be discussed in detail in chapter 2. And after getting and presenting the data, it is now time for us to analyze our data. So how do we do that? Well, in analyzing the data, we normally utilize the primary approaches to operations analysis to decide which alternative will result in the best product or service. So these primary approaches include, first, purpose of operation. Second, design of part. Third, we have tolerances and specifications. Fourth, we have materials. Fifth, we have process of manufacture. Sixth, the setup and tools. Seventh, we have working conditions. Eighth, we have materials handling. Ninth, we have plant layout. And finally, we have work design. And this will be discussed in detail in chapter 3 for the analysis of data. And after analyzing our data, the next step that we need to do is to develop the ideal method. And in developing the ideal method, we actually select the best procedure for each operation, inspection, and transportation by considering the various constraints associated with each alternative, including productivity, ergonomics, and health and safety implications. And this will be discussed in detail in chapters 3 to 7. And after developing the ideal method, we are now able to present and install the method. And in presenting and installing the method, here, what we do is we explain the proposed method in detail to those responsible for its operation and maintenance. Okay? Now, consider all details of the work center to ensure that the proposed method will provide the results being anticipated by the methods analyst. And this will be discussed in detail in Chapter 8. After presenting and installing the method, it is now time to develop a job analysis. Now, in developing a job analysis, we actually conduct a job analysis of the installed method to ensure that the operators are adequately selected, trained, and rewarded. Like the previous step, this will also be discussed in detail in Chapter 8. And after developing a job analysis, we are now able to establish time standards. And take note that as industrial engineers, we are known to be time-conscious individuals, correct? And as time-conscious individuals, we should have time management skills. And so for that matter, in establishing time standards, what we usually do is we actually establish a fair and equitable standard for the installed method. And this will be discussed in detail in chapters 9 to 15. And lastly, the last step that we need to do is to follow up the method. And in following up the method, we make sure that at regular intervals, may it be weekly, monthly, or bi-weekly, or bi-monthly, depending on your preferences or depending on your agreement with your bosses. We make sure that at regular intervals, we are able to audit the installed method to determine if the anticipated productivity and quality are being realized, whether costs were correctly projected, and whether further improvements can be made. And so, as a summary, methods engineering is the systematic close scrutiny of all direct and indirect operations to find improvements that make work easier to perform in terms of worker health and safety, and also allow work to be done in less time with less investment per unit, such as greater profitability. And the next sub-key area that we're going to be discussing, that would be work or job design. And if we say work or job design, it is used to assess how tasks or the entire job is organized within the work environment and then ensure that these are well matched to the attributes of the employee. Now, while both terms, job design and workplace design, are used interchangeably, job design has a focus on those administrative changes that are required to improve working conditions, with work design having a more pragmatic approach and addressing those adjustments that may be required to workstations, tools, and body positions to allow the worker to function more effectively. A properly designed job guarantees that the worker is able to accomplish what is required in a safe and healthy fashion, and thereby reduce physical and psychological strain. And to express it more, it also helps with the organization of work, such as in identifying issues such as work overload, repetitiveness, and limited control over work, and thereby improve an occupational safety and health, or OSH, within the organization. And remember, a well-designed job could also result in more engaged, healthy, and productive employees, right? And these outcomes would benefit both employees and the organization in general. So as part of developing or maintaining the new method, the principles of work design must be used to fit the task and the workstation ergonomically to the human operator. Again, the task or the workstation should fit to the human operator. That's the essence of it. But unfortunately, work design is typically forgotten in the quest for increased productivity. And far too often, overly simplified procedures result in machine-like repetitive jobs for the operators, leading to increased rates of work-related musculoskeletal disorders, or MSDs. Any productivity increases and reduced costs are more than offset by the increased medical care chance, and therefore, it is necessary for the methods engineer to also incorporate the principles of work design into any new method so that it will not only be more productive, but also will be safe and injury-free for the operator. And for the standards, if we see standards, these are the end results of time study or work measurement. Now, this technique establishes a time standard allowed to perform a given task based on measurements of the work content of the prescribed method, with due consideration of fatigue and for personal and unavoidable delays. Why do we need to consider fatigue? Because remember, your employees are not robots, okay? They feel tired. They feel exhausted. So that is why if we do method study, we should always consider fatigue and personal and unavoidable delays. What do we mean by personal and unavoidable delays? These are the types of delays that are unavoidable. For example, if your employee is working 8 hours per day, we should have a break time for them, like 15 minutes break in the morning and 15 minutes break in the afternoon, because there are really chances that your employees need to go to the restroom to take a pee or whatsoever. So that's something that we call personal and unavoidable delay, okay? And time study analysts also use several techniques to establish a standard. They make use of a stopwatch time study, computerized data collection, standard data, predetermined time systems, work sampling, and estimates based on historical data. Now, each technique is actually applicable to certain conditions. And remember, time study analysts must know when to use a given technique and must then use that technique judiciously and correctly. And the next key sub-area, that would be the objectives of methods, standards, and work design. So as you can see, we only have two principal objectives of methods, standards, and work design. First is to increase productivity and product reliability safely. And second is to lower unit cost, and therefore allowing more quality goods and services to be produced for more people. Take note that the ability to produce more for less will result in more jobs for more people for a greater number of hours per year, right? So only through the intelligent application of the principles of methods, standards, and work design can producers of goods and services increase, while at the same time, the purchasing potential of all consumers grow as well. Though these principles, unemployment and relief roles can be minimized, thus reducing the spiraling cost of economic support to non-producers. All right, so the next key area that we're going to be discussing today, that would be the historical development. How and when methods engineering start? So Frederick Winslow Taylor is generally considered to be the founder of modern time study in this country. However, time studies were conducted in Europe many years before Taylor's time. For example, in 1760, Jean Rudolph Pironet, a French engineer, made extensive time studies on the manufacture of number 6 common pins. Well, 60 years later, an English economist by the name of Charles W. Babbage conducted time studies on the manufacture of number 11 common pins. So when did Taylor start then his time study? Well, Taylor began his time study work in 1881 while associated with a Midvale Steel Company in Philadelphia. Although born in a wealthy family, he actually disdained his upbringing and started out serving as an apprentice. And after 12 years' work, he evolved a system based on the task. And Taylor proposed that the work of each employee be planned out by the management at least one day in advance. Workers were to receive complete written instructions describing their tasks in detail and noting the means to accomplish them. Each job was to have a standard time determined by time studies made by methods engineering experts. And in the timing process, Taylor advocated breaking up the work assignment into small divisions of effort known as elements. So experts were to time these individually and use their collective values to determine the allowed time for that certain task. And Taylor's early presentation of the findings were received without enthusiasm because many of the engineers interpreted his findings to be a new piece rate system rather than a technique for analyzing work and improving methods. So both management and employees were actually skeptical of piece rates because many standards were either typically based on the supervisor's guess or inflated by bosses to protect the performance of their departments. And so for that matter, in June 1903, at the Saratoga meeting of the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, or ASME, Taylor presented his famous paper, Shop Management, which included the elements of scientific management that are time study, standardization of all tools and tasks, use of a planning department, use of slide rules and similar time-saving implements, instruction cards for workers, bonuses for successful performance, differential rates, mnemonic systems for classifying products, routing systems, and modern cost systems. Based on this, Taylor's techniques were well received by many factory managers, and by 1917, of 113 plants that had installed scientific management, 59 considered their installations completely successful, 20 partly successful, and 34 failures. So in 1898, while at the Bethlehem Steel Company, he had resigned his post at Midvale. Taylor carried out the pig iron experiment that came to be one of the most celebrated demonstrations of his principles. So during this year, he established the correct method along with financial incentives and workers carrying 92-pound bags of iron up a ramp onto a freight car were able to increase their productivity from an average of 12.5 tons per day to between 47 and 48 tons per day. Now, this work was performed with an increase in the daily rate of $1.15 to $1.85. Taylor claimed that workmen performed at the higher rate without bringing on a strike among the men, without any quarrel with the men, and were happier and better contented. And another of Taylor's Bethlehem Steel studies that gained fame was the shoveling experiment. So what actually happened here is that workers who shoveled at Bethlehem owned their own shovels and would use the same one for any job lifting heavy iron ore to lifting light rice coal. And after considerable study, Taylor designed shovels to fit the different loads: short-handled shovels for iron ore, long-handled scoops for light rice coal. And as a result, productivity increased and the cost of handling materials decreased from 8 cents per ton to 3 cents per ton. And another of Taylor's well-known contribution was the discovery of Taylor-White process of heat treatment for tool steel. Now, in this case, studying self-hardening steels, he developed a means of hardening a chrome tungsten steel or steel alloy without rendering it brittle by heating it close to its melting point. The resulting high-speed steel more than doubled machine cutting productivity and remains in use today all over the world. And later, he developed the Taylor equation for cutting metal. And aside from Taylor comes the work of the Gilbreths. So Frank and Lillian Gilbreth were the founders of the modern motion study technique. When we say motion study technique, it is defined as the study of the body motions used in performing an operation to improve the operation by eliminating unnecessary motions, simplifying necessary motions, and then establishing the most favorable motion sequence for maximum efficiency. Now, Frank Gilbreth originally introduced his ideas and philosophies into the bricklayer's trade in which he was employed. And after introducing methods improvement through motion study, including an adjustable scaffold that he had invented, as well as operator training, he was able to increase the average number of bricks laid to 350 per worker per hour. Prior to Gilbreth's studies, 120 bricks per hour was considered a satisfactory rate of performance for a bricklayer. So there is really a significant increase in the productivity. Take note, from 120 to 350, so more than double, right? So more than anyone else, the Gilbreths were responsible for industry's recognition of the importance of a detailed study of body motions to increase production, reduce fatigue, and instruct operators in the best method of performing an operation. So what they did is they developed the technique of filming motions to study them in a technique known as micro motion study. The study of movements through the aid of slow motion moving picture is by no means confined to industrial applications. And second, in addition, the Gilbreths developed the cyclographic and chronocyclographic analysis techniques for studying the motion paths made by an operator. Now, the cyclographic method actually involves attaching a small electric light bulb to the finger or hand or part of the body being studied and then photographing the motion while the operator is performing such operation. The resulting picture then gives a permanent record of the motion pattern employed and can be analyzed for possible improvement. On the other hand, the chronocycle graphic is similar to the cycle graph, but its electric circuit is interrupted regularly, causing the light to flash. And therefore, instead of showing solid lines of the motion patterns, the resulting photograph shows short dashes of light spaced in proportion to the speed of the body motion being photographed. Consequently, with a chronocycle graphic, it is possible to compute velocity, acceleration, and deceleration, as well as to study body motions. So the world of sports has found this analysis tool updated to video invaluable as a training tool to show the development of form and scale. And aside from Gilbreth, aside from Taylor, we also have the early contemporaries. We have Carl G. Barth and Harrington Emerson. Carl G. Barth is an associate of Frederick W. Taylor, who developed a production slide rule for determining the most efficient combinations of speeds and feeds for cutting metals of various hardnesses, considering the depth of cut, size of the tool, and the life of the tool. And he is also noted for his work in determining allowances. So in this case, he investigated the number of foot pounds of work of a worker could do in a day. He then developed a rule that equated a certain push or pull on a worker's arms with the amount of weight that worker could handle for a certain percentage of the day. And for Harrington Emerson, he applied scientific methods to work on the Santa Fe Railroad and wrote a book, 12 Principles of Efficiency, in which he made an effort to inform management of procedures for efficient operation. So what he actually did was he reorganized the company, integrated the shop procedures, installed standard cost and a bonus plan, and transferred its accounting work to Hollerith tabulating machines. So this effort resulted in annual savings in excess of $1.5 million and the recognition of his approach termed efficiency engineering. And aside from that, we also have Henry Lawrence Gantt. And Henry Lawrence Gantt developed simple graphs that would measure performance while visually showing projected schedules. This production control tool was actually enthusiastically adopted by the shipbuilding industry during World War I. And for the first time, this tool made it possible to compare actual performance against the original plan and to adjust daily schedules in accordance with capacity, backlog, and customer requirements. And also, Gantt is also known for his invention of wage payment system that rewarded workers for above standard performance, eliminated any penalty for failure, and offered the boss a bonus for every worker who performed above standards. So Gantt emphasized human relations and promoted scientific management as more than an inhuman speed up of labor. And finally, we have Franklin D. Roosevelt. And Franklin D. Roosevelt motion and time study received added stimulus during World War II when he advocated establishing standards for increasing production through the U.S. Department of Labor. So the stated policy actually advocated greater pay for greater output, but without an increase in unit labor costs, incentive schemes to be collectively bargained between labor and management, and the use of time study or past records to set production standards. And the next key sub area that we're going to be discussing, that would be, or the emergence of work design. Now, work design is a relatively new science which deals with designing the task, workstation, and working environment to fit the human operator better. Again, if we say work design, it's fitting the task to operator, or fitting the workstation to operator, not fitting the operator to the task, and not fitting the operator to the workstation. Again, it should be fitting the task or workstation or working environment to the human operator. And in the US, it is more typically known as human factors, while internationally, it is better known as ergonomics, which is derived from the Greek words ergo, which means work, and nomos, which means loss. So etymologically speaking, ergonomics means the loss of work. Now, in the US, after the initial work of Taylor and the Gilbreths, the selection and training of military personnel during World War I and the industrial psychology experiments of the Harvard Graduate School at Western Electric were important contributions to the work design area. In Europe, during and after World War I, the British Industrial Fatigue Board actually performed numerous studies on how or on human performance under various conditions. And these were later extended to heat stress and other conditions by the British Admiralty and Medical Research Council. And finally, the last key subtopic that we're going to be discussing, that would be the different professional organizations of industrial engineering or industrial and systems engineering. So we have a Taylor Society in 1915. We also have Society of Industrial Engineers in 1917. We have the American Management Association in 1913. We have Society for Advancement Management, or SAM, in 1936. We have Institute of Industrial Engineers, or IIE, in 1948. We have Ergonomics Research Society in 1949. And we also have the Human Factors and Ergonomics Society in 1957. Now, since 1911, there has been an organized effort to keep industry abreast of the latest developments in the techniques inaugurated by Taylor and Gilbreth. And technical organizations have contributed much toward bringing the science of time study, work design, and methods engineering up to the present day standards. So in 1915, the Taylor Society was founded to promote the science of management. While in 1917, the society was founded to promote the the Society of Industrial Engineers was organized by those interested in production methods. So the American Management Association, or AMA, traces its origins to 1913, when a group of training managers formed the National Association of Corporate Schools. Its various divisions sponsor courses and publications on productivity improvement, work measurement, wage incentives, work simplification, and clerical standards. The Society for the Advancement of Management, or SAM, on the other hand, was formed in 1936 by the merger of the Society of Industrial Engineers and the Taylor Society. This organization actually emphasized the importance of time study and methods and wage payment. Industry has used SAM's time study rating films over a long period of years. Sam annually offers the Taylor Key for the outstanding contribution to the advancement of the science of management and the Gilbreth Medal for noteworthy achievement in the field of motion, skill, and fatigue study. So in 1972, Sam combined forces with AIEE, so the Institute of Industrial Engineers, or IIE, was founded in 1948 with the purposes of maintaining the practice of industrial engineering on a professional level, fostering a high degree of integrity among the members of the industrial engineering profession, encouraging and assisting education and research in areas of interest to industrial engineers, promoting the interchange of ideas and information among members of the industrial engineering profession, such as publishing the journal IIE Transactions, serving the public interest by identifying persons qualified to practice as industrial engineers, and finally, promoting the professional registration of industrial engineers. So in the area of work design, the first professional organization, the Ergonomics Research Society, was founded in the UK in 1949. And it started the first professional journal, Ergonomics, in 1957. The U.S. professional organization, the Human Factors and Ergonomic Society, was founded in 1957. All right, I think that's a good place to stop. If you have questions, please let me know on the comment section below. And if you like this video, please don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell button for the latest updates.